Hare Krishna. Today morning, we are discussing about the pastime of Sati speaking before she decides to end the body that she has got from Daksha. And here she is telling that, oh Daksha, you are finding faults in someone who is faultless. And she is reproaching him for his fault-finding mentality, which is essentially, he is considering Shiva to be uncultured. That's what he said. You don't know the etiquette of cultured people by which you should respect a respectable person. And of course, that respectable person was he himself. So you didn't respect me. And therefore, you don't deserve a place among cultured people. And that's why he did not give any place in the sacrificial arena for him. So she's talking about, you have found fault thus, and therefore you have become condemned. You have become reproachable. So I'll talk about 3 points. First is, I talk about how the mind's tendency to see black eventually spreads, by which we see the black even in the white. I'll talk about the mental tendency of fault finding. The second point I'll talk about is how, even if people are not faultless, we can find faults less. And lastly, I'll talk about how we can focus on people's potentials, not their problems. So, the first point is that our mind is largely a creature of habit. And sometimes when we live in a community and we have certain abilities, we have certain skills by which we can see that others are doing certain things wrong. So when we have these skills, then we can see that this is black and this is white. So some people are color blind. I mean, they just can't see certain colors. See, blindness is very evident. Somebody is blind, they can't see anything. But color blindness is not that evident. Sometimes some people may have some color blindness throughout their life, and maybe if they decide to join the Air Force or something, and that time of test is done, that's when they come to know, I can't see this color. So color blindness is not so easily noticeable. So this is that everybody has certain blind spots. Blind spots means that they just can't see certain things. And some people, say person A has a blind spot in something, and person B can see that very well, that particular color very well. Then what happens? Those two people can create, they end up in tremendous conflict. So the person who is color blind, so what's wrong? There's nothing wrong over here. Everything is fine. And a person who is very has acute color sensation over there, hey, this is not meant to be of this color. Why you put this color over here? Where am I putting? You notice it. So I come across this a lot, because at least in the area of language, writing is my service, and I am very conscious of words. So any place I go to, even if it be a temple or a seminar hall, I become a self-appointed proofreader. And then, every notice, every announcement, everything I see, I tend to find faults in it. Is there anything wrong over it? And the worst part is that very few people have that kind of grammatical sense. So if I find out some fault, this doesn't make sense, this has to change like this. Then the common response I get, everybody understands. Why don't you understand? Because of that, it's very frustrating. I can say this is wrong. It's no, but everybody understands it. What is the big deal? So, of course, sometimes grammatical mistakes can be very seriously wrong. And you have to point them out. Once I was an editor for a magazine for the local newsletter in Pune, and then we had done a 6-session course. So we wrote a small article about it. So 6-session course held in Pune. Somehow something went wrong in typing, and instead of I in the 6, we got, somehow it got typed E. So it became a 6-session course held in ISKCON Pune. So just before we were about to print the magazine, at that time we noticed it. Otherwise it would be a big problem. So of course, sometimes faults can be serious. But frequently, these faults are minor and they are understandable. So somebody who has a very strong linguistic sense and somebody who has very little linguistic sense, then they can be very incompatible. So now if somebody has a strong linguistic sense, they can say this is black, this is white. For somebody who doesn't have that sense, everything is white. As long as it's communicated. What is the big deal? So at one level, if somebody has a particular service, to see that this is black and this is white is important. But the problem, I also serve as an editor, and I have talked with devotees who are editors. They've told me that they have to, especially when they are reading Prabhupada's books or reading Acharya's books, they have to consciously turn off their critical faculty. Or at least tone it down. Because otherwise, we can bring that everywhere. And then, say, one devotee is a Sanskrit scholar. And he told me that after he learned Sanskrit, throughout the classes that he would hear, he would find fault with devotees' pronunciation of Sanskrit. And he would find faults with the way, sometimes if we don't know Sanskrit very well, we may oversimplify and misrepresent the meanings of words exactly. We arrive at a conclusion, but the analysis is not right to arrive at a conclusion. So he said, after some time he consciously realized, I am not attending Bhagavatam class to evaluate Sanskrit. I am attending Bhagavatam class to purify myself, to get spiritual inspiration, to get spiritual understanding, to get spiritual reminders. So what happens is, that there is black, there is white. And the capacity to discern that is important. But when that becomes our default disposition, so it's the capacity to find faults is a faculty, it's a capacity. And there are times when it needs to be used. And not being able to use it is a problem. If we are making a big announcement somewhere, like I was saying, we're publishing a magazine, and there if you don't notice the mistake of words, it's a big problem. It's a resource, and there is a time when it is not only desirable, it's essential. But when that becomes our default disposition, when that becomes the sole way we look at things, then so it's a particular spectacle which we need to use at times. And if we have been given that spectacle, it's valid, it's an asset. But if that becomes the spectacle, that becomes the glasses with which we see everything, when we see everyone, then it can become a problem. So we have to see black and white. But if we keep seeing the black, this is black, this is black, this is black, then even when there is white, we will look for the black in the white. So the mind, whatever it does repeatedly, that becomes its default disposition. And we have to be careful that we don't let that critical mentality become our default mentality. Critical mentality is a resource, and it is a useful resource. In some situations, it's an indispensable resource. Some people at least have to have it. But that cannot be the default mentality that we have. Then we will not be able to connect with anyone. Whatever we'll be able to connect, that connection will be for disconnection. Because we'll criticize and we'll alienate people. So the more than whether people have faults or not, more than whether there are mistakes or not, that's a reality which we have to discuss. But more than that, we have to see what is my attitude, what is my mentality, what is the disposition of my mind. If I am becoming more and more of a fault finder, then that is a problem with my mentality. So, and especially this can happen even with philosophy. Sometimes when we understand the philosophy, then we can say, this is philosophically correct, this is philosophically wrong. And it's important to understand that. At the same time, philosophy is a part of a person's defining identity. I work with Giriraj Maharaj sometimes in editing some of his books. So he's written a massive book on Srila Prabhupada's battle to build the Juhu temple. It's almost like 800-900 page book. Beautifully written. So there he is telling that he had many interactions with Prabhupada. And Prabhupada was very strong in condemning Mayavadi philosophy. And when Prabhupada went to America for the first time, he stayed at Dr. Mishra's yoga studio. And Dr. Mishra was a Mayavadi. And Prabhupada once told Giriraj Maharaj, and Giriraj Maharaj told me that this was a revolution for me. He said that philosophically, we would argue like anything, but culturally, we were friends. So this capacity to differentiate between philosophy and culture, this is very important. And sometimes we take the philosophy and make whatever philosophical position a person has into the whole identity of the person. In today's world especially, when somebody says, oh, everything is one, we are all God. To call such people Mayavadis is actually to give them too much credit. Actually, Mayavad is a philosophy. And Shankaracharya was a serious philosopher. What modern, what we call as Mayavadis, they are actually new Mayavadis. And they have got a very oversimplified idea of Mayavad, which is actually a caricature, which is not actually a Mayavad. And most people today who say everything is one, they just read something somewhere, heard something somewhere, it sounded nice to them, yes, everything is one. So, actually speaking, if we start criticizing and condemning them as Mayavadis, we simply alienate them. Because they're not really Mayavadis. They're just that something which they have heard and something which they have taken in themselves. So if we are very critical, okay, this philosophy is wrong, this philosophy is wrong, this philosophy is wrong. That's okay. We do have to differentiate. We do have to identify what is philosophically right and what is philosophically wrong. But at many times, even when a person speaks a particular philosophical position, that is just a part, that is just a part of their understanding. And when we become too critical, then we can't see the white, we can't see the white when there is prominently white and there is a little black. We zero only onto the black. And that mentality is a big, big problem. When we start looking, a devotee is meant to see Krishna everywhere. Yomam Pashyati Sarvatra, Krishna says. One who sees me everywhere. So, I'll come to this point in the end of the discussion also. But, instead of seeing how Krishna is present everywhere, we may end up seeing how Krishna is absent everywhere. Even when a wonderful service is being done, say, this is not done right, this is not done right, this is not done right. So, if we start seeing that, how Krishna is absent everywhere, then the biggest issue is that Krishna will become absent in our own hearts. Because we will not be Krishna conscious. We will be conscious of Krishna unconsciousness. Yes, if something is not done right, it has to be seen. But that cannot be our default disposition. So the tendency to see only the black. Initially, I see black, white, that is good. But then I start seeing only the black. And then I start focusing on the black. And then once my mind gets habituated to looking at the black, even when there is white, I'll see only the black. And that is the fault of the fault-finding mentality. So before doing any fault-finding, we need to find the fault of the fault-finding mentality. And the fault of the fault-finding mentality is that when that becomes a default mentality, we can't see good even when good is prominently present. So, any questions or comments about this at this stage? Yes.
So we might work in a team where the guru or the pure devotee, he's leading the team and he has a conception, like he's seen, his default mentality is to see white everywhere, whereas the team members are not yet there in terms of, you know, seeing. So for the team members, that it's like any decision doesn't make sense. So how do we harmonize this tendency in a team?
So decision is made by the by one of the members of the team.
Leaders, especially, they have their tendency for fault finding is almost nil. In fact, they see no faults, even when the faults are present. But for the team members to digest that and move on, you know, when faults are apparent, so it becomes difficult sometimes.
Yeah, good point. So actually, this leads to the second point, which I'm going to speak. So I'll just speak that directly, and then I'll address the question. The second point was, even if we have to find, even if people are not faultless, we can find faultless. Now, what does this mean? That while living in the world, there is definitely something which is right and something which is wrong. So, once we understand that this is what needs to be done, this is how, say, if somebody is driving a car, and if they are driving on the wrong side of the road, we can't say that I'll not find faults. We have to point it out. So there are some places where pointing out what is wrong is essential. Otherwise, the service will not be done. So how do we point out faults? Now there are ways in which we can do it where the person doesn't feel pointed out or hurt. Say, for example, every time when I go to America and come back to India, you know, somebody is driving in a car, I always end up going to the wrong side of the car. Uh-huh. Because in America, we drive on one side, so the driver sits on one side, the person going sits on the other side. You keep making mistakes. So, instead of saying, hey, you're driving on the wrong side of the road, you could just say that, okay, in India, we drive on this side of the road. In America, we drive on that side of the road. So, it's immediately understood. It basically, fault can be pointed out without pointing at the person. When I said, even if people are not faultless, we can find faultless. That means, when we are finding out the fault, what are we pointing at? Say, if somebody has made a spelling mistake, I can say, you spelled this word wrong. Or I can say, this word is spelled like this. It's a small difference, but you know, when I write and people review my writings, like I do it for others also do it for me. So this difference can make a big difference actually. So if somebody says that you are wandering all over the place, your article is very incoherent. Now, I have found that there are different devotees and different senior devotees also review the articles, and different devotees have different ways of doing it. So, this is a small statement that your article is all over the place. And this article is all over the place. Okay, the amount of hurt that you feel is much, much lesser. This article is my article only. But don't point it out like that. So, there's a way in which we can speak the truth. But we can speak the truth in a way that doesn't directly hurt the person. Just because the truth is unpalatable doesn't mean that it has to be spoken unpalatably. Sometimes we may use the truth is bitter. That we may use that as an argument for speaking the truth bitterly. The two are very different things. The truth is bitter and speaking the truth bitterly are very different things. When I studied public speaking, one simple principle was that instead of, if you see blank faces in the audience, don't ask, are you understanding? Nobody wants to admit it, because if I say I'm not understanding, that means I'm a fool. Nobody wants to admit I'm a fool. So instead, ask, Am I making myself clear?
The essence is the same. But, or even, are you instead of saying, is this understanding? So there are three things over here, you know that? That we point fault with the person, we point fault with the concept, and we point out some fault which we see. This is a subtle difference. So what is the same point? Are you understanding? Is this point clear? Or am I making myself clear? In an interaction, I am there, the person is there, and in between the interaction is there. Or any particular service is there. So that person is doing the service is here and I am here. So what is our trust? That can make a big difference. So I know one reviewer who is very, very sensitive. So how they always give reviews, I have a problem with this. Now when they say I have a problem, okay, you have a problem. But then I read it, hey, this is actually a problem here, isn't it? So, but you don't feel threatened by that. So basically, whenever something is done wrong, if we can find faults less, that doesn't mean we say that the bad is good. That would be untrue and that can be a disservice. So, it's just that if we could do it in a less intrusive or threatening way, it can make a big difference. In the study of language, it is said that if you are writing a sentence, what you speak at the end of the sentence, that is what people carry. So, somebody is asking, how is this person doing? Now, if that person wants to give a positive review or a negative review, they can just speak the same words, but just subtly shift it. He had problems earlier, but he's fine now. But he's stable now. He's stable now, but he had problems earlier. The same statement, same words also. But, oh, he's fine now. He's stable now. Oh, he had problems earlier. So the carry home message becomes positive or negative based on what is placed at the end. So similarly, when there are some faults, and we do have to, sometimes we may be the persons who have to take responsibility for fixing the mess after it comes up. So then naturally we would like to fix it before the mess comes up. And that's desirable. But we could do it in a way that is less threatening. That's why Krishna says, anudvega karam vakyam satyam priyahitam jayat swadhyaya vyasanam chaiva vanmayam tapauchyate. So, anudvega karam vakyam, speak in a way that doesn't hurt. That doesn't hurt. That doesn't agitate people. Krishna is saying that speak truthfully. But it's interesting, the first austerity of speech that he says is speak non-agitatingly. Because the tendency of the mind of most of us is to speak whatever comes in the mind. Some people speak to express their thoughts. And some people speak to discover their thoughts. They speak, I didn't mean to speak that, I shouldn't have spoken that. Now, how many of you had this experience of slip of tongue? Almost all of us. Sometimes if it happens on the Vyasasan, it can be extremely embarrassing. I remember once, I gave a class, not at the Vyasasan, but after that a devotee came, after the class, and he had a big smile on his face. Your class was terrible. And he was smiling so happily. I said, what happened? And he saw me bewildered. And he said, oh, I meant terrific. So, we can have slip of tongue and sometimes it can be easily corrected. But sometimes, we may not even realize that the tongue has slipped. So basically, if we make it a intention that whatever I am going to speak, let me try to speak it as less agitatingly as possible. How can I do that? One way is by sometimes if this person has made such a mistake, I am going to put them in their place. So before we put others in their place, let's put ourselves in their place. Let's put ourselves in their place means, if somebody spoke this to me, how would I feel about it? If somebody spoke this to me, I've done this, I'm saying all this is easy to speak and applying, I also struggle. But whenever I've been able to ask this question to myself, it makes me pause. And I may still speak the same thing, but I'll speak it much more sensitively. If somebody spoke this to me, how would I feel about it? And it's always, we can't actually be empathic. Even this is, to take this further down, we could say that if say we are senior and somebody is junior, and then if somebody had spoken to this to me when I was 2 years old in Krishna consciousness, when I was 5 years old in Krishna consciousness, that can actually deepen the empathy. That means if I put myself not only in their place, from my place, but I go to their place actually. So if somebody is a seasoned publisher with respect to writing may not be relevant to all of you, but that's what is relevant to me. So I have experience of this area. So say somebody has written many articles and has published, or let's take a speaking example, speaking might be easier for them. Say somebody has given hundreds of classes, and then somebody points out faults with their class. That will still hurt, but because they've done so many classes, they have confidence that I can do this service next time. But that faults become easier to digest. Of course, the ego can come in the way, and how dare you find faults with me? That can also happen. But if the person is a little sober, they don't feel insecure about the service itself. Yes, I'm securely situated in the service, and I can improve this. But suppose somebody has just given their first class, and after that fault is pointed out, then what will happen? Oh my God, better I don't do this service only, so many mistakes happen. So when somebody is taking the first tentative steps, say a baby is just learning to walk, a small child is learning to walk, and then the mother, instead of cheering, oh how nicely walking, why are you not walking straight? Well, if you do that, the child says, I'll not walk only. So we need to put ourselves in their place. Before we put others in their place, we have to put ourselves in their place. And so this question, how would this sound to me? How would I feel if somebody spoke this to me? When I was 5 years old, 2 years old, or when I was doing this service new, that can actually create a greater amount of sensitivity. And addressing the point of, say, other devotees not finding faults and we having to find faults. Yes, I think if we are responsible for a particular service, then we have to, as a service, point out that how will this work? Rather than saying that this will not work. How will this work if this happens? So basically, instead of giving a judgment to people, we can point out, if this happens, how will you do this? Then what happens? Rather than people feeling that, oh, you are finding fault with me, they themselves take responsibility. Maybe they'll come up with a solution. Or maybe they'll come up with, okay, when it comes, we'll do this. Or they may themselves abandon. So instead of putting ourselves, this, I am the judge and you are wrong, we include them in the team and say, okay, how would we deal if this happens? So, you know, somebody is trying to discuss with, somebody is trying to say, talk about logical reasons for the existence of God. Then, instead of saying that, with this argument you can refute any atheist, you could say instead, how would, if you had an atheistic friend, how would the atheistic friend respond to this argument? Then they may have some objection, this argument doesn't make sense, this argument won't work. Then rather than they attacking us or we attacking them, we become joint partners. Okay, if this happens, how do we deal with it? So that way, if we create a sense of inclusion, then again, that's a way of finding faults less. Any questions or comments about this?
Is it possible? I mean,
does it have the influence over the community? Just like in West, many people try to follow this kind of mentality and deal with the students. And because of that, later stages it become very difficult to handle if something direct, something negative really comes.
Mm-hmm.
Yes. And because person become used to the accepting party.
Yeah, okay.
This kind of...
That's a good question.
So if we become very used to others being very sensitive in correcting us, and then if we see somebody who is very direct and blunt in correcting, then it may become very difficult for us to deal with it. Yes, that's true. We all will face difficult people in our lives. It's said that some people bring happiness wherever they go. And some people bring happiness whenever they go.
So there are people who are very,
very blunt fault finders. It's interesting, sometimes in English, the opposite words mean the same thing. Normally sharp and blunt are opposite. A knife is either sharp or either blunt. But a blunt speaker, a person who speaks bluntly and a person who speaks sharply, that means the same thing. You know, that words hurt us if they speak bluntly. Now bluntly there means what? That actually it is, they just speak things as they are. So, or at least as they see they are. Now we all need some amount of, as they say, a thick skin to withstand such people. But just because we all need a thick skin doesn't mean that it is our duty to thicken other people's skin. I mean, to put it another way, say all of us are meant to develop humility. But is it that if we go around insulting others, disrespecting others, criticizing others, and we tell them, I'm helping you become humble. Well, nobody appointed you to create humility in everyone else, isn't it? Our culture is amanina manadina. So we strive to develop sensitivity, and of course there will be difficult people who will not be sensitive. And then working with such people is a challenge. I was at one temple in America and I was talking with some devotees over there. And one devotee told about another prominent leader. He says, he's a wonderful person to admire from a distance. So, there is something in English called as condemning by faint praise. If somebody offers us prasad and then they ask, how was the prasad? It was edible.
Now, prasad is like delicious, edible. That's we're not criticizing it, but it is a criticism. A severe criticism. So, when somebody says they're a wonderful person to admire from a distance, that means essentially they're not a very pleasant person to be close to them. So, it's criticizing, it is condemning by faint criticism. Sorry, by faint praise.
So there are some people who are difficult like that. And dealing with them is itself a challenge. So at that time we can see that, you know, Krishna also knows that dealing with this particular person is difficult. And Krishna will appreciate that. So when we have to do a service with somebody who's a difficult person, one way I console myself is that this is a, or encourage myself is that actually I am doing two services, not one.
That means
I am doing this service and I am doing this service with this person. So doing it with this person is also a service. So actually, if you see, when we are going through difficult situations, Krishna acknowledges that. Rukmini was serving Krishna wonderfully, but when Krishna gave a parijat flower to Rukmini, and then Satyabhama demanded, and Krishna gave a whole parijat tree to Satyabhama. And after that, when Krishna met Rukmini, Krishna expected Rukmini will demand something from him. And Rukmini did not demand anything from him. Krishna became very pleased with that. And later on, Krishna appreciated that. So if somebody is doing something in a difficult situation, Krishna knows that. Now we may say, this person is not difficult, but I find it difficult working with this person. That's also true. Krishna also sees from our perspective. So when there is some people with whom it's difficult to work, we all have our limits of tolerance. And if it's unbearably difficult, then we may say, I can't work with this person. But if we can, it's a manageable difficulty, then we can see that that is also a way we are doing another service and we are getting purified by that. So we do need to develop a thick skin. That is true. But that doesn't mean that that uses a license to be insensitive with others in the name of developing a thick skin, helping them to develop thick skin. There's a difference between what I need to tolerate and how I need to conduct myself. So, I was talking with one senior sannyasi, and he was telling that he tries to follow this principle: with yourself, be like Bhakti Siddhanta; with others, be like Bhakti Vinoda. That is, be strict with yourself, be accommodating, understanding, and with others. So yes, we should try to develop a thick skin ourselves. But with others, we try to be as understanding, as gentle, as sensitive as possible. Okay? So the last point I'll speak now is that focus on people's potentials, not their problems. Krishna says that apaishunam, aversion to fault finding, is a characteristic of the godly being. Annanadi shunya. The characteristic of a pure devotee said that actually don't see that is free from the mentality to find faults with others. When Srila Prabhupada went to America, at that time, when he went to America, actually people had so many faults. In fact, let me put this another way. That when Prabhupada came back to India the second time to Vrindavan, first he came in 1968, at that time he brought 2-3 disciples with him. But 1970 when he came again, he brought a busload of disciples with him. Several buses in fact. And it created a sensation in Vrindavan. And like a hometown Swami became globally successful. Vrindavan was proud of Prabhupada. And then in Vrindavan a big program was organized to honor Prabhupada. And then the local municipality heads, everybody had come. And they had invited some Gaudiya Math leaders also to come over. Now for them, Prabhupada was like a very junior devotee. Initially when say we come and somebody else comes 5 years, 10 years down the line, there's a big difference. But 20 years, 30 years down the line, a 5 year difference or even a 10 year difference is no big difference. So for Prabhupada was not at all a noteworthy leader in Gaudiya Math. And they were sannyasis and gurus. So some of them they found it a little difficult to digest the fame of Prabhupada, the success of Prabhupada. And like I said, condemning with faint praise. So one of the godbrothers tried to do something like that. He said that, oh, Bhaktivedanta Swami has been successful in making so many lekchas and yamanas as devotees. He said, all his life he was a businessman. So as a businessman, he had to deal with all kinds of people who were of low class. And that's why he had a lot of experience. Now we were born in Brahmin family. We always, from childhood, we were sannyasis. And we always interacted with pure people. But it's still wonderful that Swami Maharaj has spread Krishna consciousness all over the world and made all these lectures and yavanas into devotees. Now, hear what he's saying. Oh, he was impure. He was mixed with impure people. And that's why he had a habit of mixing with impure people. So it's actually a criticism. But the test of our purity is not just how we stay away from impure people. But it's also how we inspire impure people to become pure. That both are tests of our purity. If somebody is an epidemic hit area, then it's important for them to take the vaccine properly or take the immunization properly so that they don't get infected. And at one level you could say this, the potency of this medication or the potency of this doctor, the potency of this medical staff is that although they are in this infected area, they have not become infected. But to not become infected is not the success of the medical staff. That is one level of success. But a bigger level of success is that the medical staff is also able to able to give the medicine to those who are infected so that they also become cured of infection. So Prabhupada saw the impurity in people. But Prabhupada did not focus on that. Prabhupada focused on the spiritual potential. The spark of spirituality that is there in people, that is what Prabhupada focused on. And in fact, if you see, when he went to America and he went to the hippies, and you could say that for the hippies, the only regulative principle was to break all regulative principles. Mm-hmm. Just constantly, just a part of their life it was. But the Prabhupada saw that they had some interest in Krishna. They had some interest in bhakti, and he found that. So whenever we are interacting with anyone, there are of course degrees. Sometimes we may not have the purity or the potency to withstand some people's, it's not that they are impure, but it may be that it may contaminate us. So we have to be we have to know our limits. But still the point is, when we look at someone, we look at their potential, not look at the problem. I'll conclude with one story. When I first went to America, one of the things that struck me was that how many people have pets, have dogs. And in many metropolitan cities in America, especially among Caucasians, Caucasians is Americans, Europeans who came to America, it says the number of, in families, the number of dogs is more than the number of children. So especially it is the immigrants from the Middle East, from India, from China, who are growing, and through the population is growing, but then American population itself going down for various reasons. It's complicated, but anyway, so people have a lot of dogs, and I was surprised to find that even devotees have dogs. So I was quite taken aback by that, and then I met one very senior devotee who is very dedicated, prominent leader in our movement, and he has a big dog. So I was a little confused, but then I interacted with him quite a bit and I talked with him. So then he told me that actually, and then I asked him, bro, why do you... It is a difficult question to ask, but I just asked him. So he told me something very striking, which realized how much off I was. He said that there's something called therapy dogs. So he said, I have epilepsy, I get fits. And there are dogs which are trained specifically. If the dog strays the person continuously, then that dog senses when the person is going to get a fit. And then the dog wants, and the dog cushions the person. So what happens is that if somebody's, the dog anticipates before the person that I'm going to get a fit. And he said, once I was climbing up a steep stair, and this dog caught my foot, and didn't allow me to climb. So I want to go, and he's pulling. And then I didn't understand, and I was angry with the dog. But then suddenly, I had a blue blank. And then as I started falling, the dog cushioned the foot. And the dog has a particular way of barking, and the dog goes on the road. And people are trained in such a way that the dog has a particular badge around them. So if that dog starts barking loudly, then what happens? Any passerby who sees, they understand, oh, there's an emergency. And they will call the ambulance for help. So he said, this dog has saved my life twice. So now, I had no idea that this kind of dog existed. Or So we may go in to our own way and say, dogs are fine and attached to dogs. But the reality is often much, much bigger than what we perceive it to be. So I think I mentioned this in my last time also, I hadn't come here. After traveling across the world, I have understood, I have come up with a definition of humility. Humility means to acknowledge the complexity of reality. I have a particular framework and I approach with this. This is how it is. And this is right, this is wrong. But reality is much more complex than what I think it to be. So, yes, somebody has a dog. I don't know why they have it. That's a problem for me. But what is the potential? This devotee is doing so much service to Krishna. Focus on the potential. If somebody new is coming, in that new person, they may be so interested in bhakti. They may be practicing bhakti. They may be interested in bhakti. But we might see something objectionable with it. Oh, this person is going to this organization. This person is eating this kind of food. This person is dressing in this kind of way. This person is doing like this. So now, of course, we have to protect our bhakti. But if there is a spiritual spark, we need to focus on that spiritual spark. And once that spiritual spark is ignited, then people can take up bhakti and march ahead in their spiritual life. So that capacity to look for the good even in the bad, that actually is the defining quality of a compassionate preacher. Otherwise we will be preachers, but we will be judgmental preachers. And we will not bring people to Krishna. I just conclude this point with a particular reflection. Sometimes we feel that I have brought so many people to Krishna. This person became a devotee because of me. This person became a devotee because of me. This person became a devotee because of me. But there is no count of how many people did not come to Krishna because of me. The way I spoke, the way I acted, the way I conducted myself. How many people I alienated from Krishna? So if we try to become a little more sensitive of that, look at, many times we look at people's problems and we alienated them. If we look at people's potentials, we can help more and more people come closer to Krishna. So I'll summarize. I spoke three main points. I first spoke about how the capacity to see black and white is a strength. It is a resource which we need, which is desirable and even essential in certain situations. But if that critical mentality, instead of being a resource, becomes our default mentality, then we start seeing black everywhere, even in the white. Instead of seeing how Krishna is present everywhere, we start looking at how Krishna is absent everywhere. And then we start alienating people because of that. So, if we have to find fault, even if people are not faultless, we can find faultless. That I talked about how, instead of saying the problem is with that person, we can say, look at the problem in the service. Or we can say that I have a problem with this. So the way we speak something can be less or more hurting or threatening for a person. So you can speak the truth, but speak it in a way that is less hurting. And also, rather than immediately speaking out our mind, you can say, how would I feel if somebody spoke this to me when I was at that person's level? That we will bring some bricks on whatever we are going to speak. Instead of putting ourselves in their place, we first put ourselves in their place. And instead of just finding out the problem in what people are doing, we make them a partner with us, or we ourselves become a partner. Instead of saying this is not work, how will we make this work if this goes wrong like this? And lastly, I talked about focus on people's potentials, not their problems. Prabhupada, when he went to the West, he could have seen so many faults in people, but instead he focused on this interest in Krishna that we had. And if we focus on that, then we can attract many, many more people to Krishna. And we can encourage each other in our shared journey towards Krishna. Humility means to acknowledge the complexity of reality and not just make snap judgments based on our presumptions, but to try to learn and give people the benefit of doubt. By that way, we can all encourage each other positively and move on towards Krishna. Thank you very much. Are there any questions? Yes.
Hare Krishna. Thank you very much for these two points that you mentioned about presenting the faults less and seeing the potential. That really resonated with me. I was just reflecting why I am not like that. I found two reasons within me. One is we are usually critical and ruthless in our fault presentation with those whom we are very close to. Like either we should have spent a lot of time with that person. So initially when we meet a person, we see the potential and so on. But over a period of time, we become extremely critical too. Or even when we grow in stature, even from an institutional point of view, mentioned how Prabhupada, you know, he accepted all these hippies. But if you look at our movement today, the kind of people who walked into the 22nd Avenue, if they walk into a temple, I don't think we'll even allow them to walk past the main gate. So is it that time spent with a person, or and two, growth in stature, are we becoming more closed?
Thoughtful question. So,
is it that we find faults with people because we have become very familiar with them, we spend a lot of time with them, and also because we have grown in our stature, say ISKCON has become an established movement, so hippies, we won't allow them to enter into our premises also at times. Yeah. I would say that it's not necessarily finding faults. Let's take the second point, that there are different kinds of outreach for different kinds of people. So there are certain standards which need to be followed in traditional places. Say, I was with a devotee in America, and he told me that he found it so strange that it was a girl whom he was seeing, he introduced him to the temple. But he said, we came together to the temple, but when we came, we were told to sit separately. He said, I was completely lost over there. What is going on? Who is this? What is this? We just couldn't be there. So, if that is the culture of people, then we can't bring that culture to the temple. But we need a place where people can be who they are, and still they can get introduced to Krishna. In fact, Prabhupada had a vision. We have a temple in LA. It was before that a church. And they had, you know, churches have those, what do they call them? The rows of seats, what is the pews. So they had those rows of pews, and Prabhupada said, keep that. And Prabhupada also said that, let people come in with their shoes. And he said, have the deities elsewhere. That's what they did initially, but eventually they found that they needed space, bigger hall, and that was the biggest hall. So they changed that. But Prabhupada was quite accommodating for people. Like yesterday I said, we bring people to Krishna and we bring Krishna to people. And these two are distinct activities. When we are bringing Krishna to people, we can't force our terms on people. And there has to be a safe zone where people can come and experience Krishna on their terms. And afterwards, we bring people to Krishna. That means we get them to a temple. So, yes, so if there are hippies, we don't want them the way they are to come to our temples. But that doesn't mean that they can't practice bhakti. We may have to create certain forums. So as of where they can come. So it's not that trying to have standards is not necessarily a fault-finding mentality. Maintaining standards and pointing out those who are not following the standards. But there has to be a space where people who are not yet ready to follow the standards can also experience bhakti. So, demarcating that is important, and creating spaces for people according to their background. When I was in America, I had gone to a prominent church, and they have three services every Sunday, and every one of them is full. In fact, they have now created they have so many people in their church that actually they have created CCTV and people sit in the parking lot in the car and from there they see the service. So, and they have three services. So they have an English service, then they have a Latin American service, Spanish service, and then they have an English service for African Americans. So there they have separate food for them. They have a separate way of presenting using African American lore, using songs and stuff like that. So they create within that same place presentation according to the culture of the people. So I would say that that contextualization has to be done. And second point of, yes, does familiarity breed contempt? Yeah, sometimes when you're too familiar with people, it is true that what happens is we tend to presume that the person understands us. When somebody is new, we understand that I have to create trust in this person. And we have to make sure that this person understands that I have a relationship with them. That we develop a relationship after which we then speak some corrective points. But over a period of years, we presume that the relationship is already established. But sometimes, but our every relationship of ours, it is, we sometimes think it's like a fixed deposit. I invested this much money and it is there. Every relationship is like actually capital invested in the stock market. So sometimes we can see the stock rates are going down, and sometimes we may not even notice. We think, oh, I have this much money, I have 5 lakh rupees, and you find out actually I have only 1 lakh rupees. The stock rate has gone down. So sometimes we assume that I have a good relationship with this person, but you know, what is the value of the stock? We don't know. So we can't always be on our guard with every person. Some people also we need to be comfortable and just relax with them. But in general, if something is, if we are that close to that person, then we also understand what are their vulnerable spots. That, okay, this is these are areas where this person is quite sensitive. And if we have to speak something in that area, then we need to be a little cautious about it. So if we know people well, then that also means that we know their sensitivities. Not that we think that I'm so close that I don't have to care for their sensitivity. But rather, I become more especially careful with respect to their sensitivities. Otherwise, it's not so much contempt. We may still have respect for the person, but there may not be sensitivity, because we just take people for, we don't take the person for granted. That can also happen, but we take the relationship for granted. The same statement, if I know if I speak to this person, it will actually seriously impede my relationship. But I presume nothing like this will happen in this relationship. But it may not be like that. It may not. So sometimes we may have to, periodically we need to reevaluate what is the stock in this relationship. How do I, whenever difficulties come up in the relationship, how does the other person respond? Does the person become like alienated from me? Does the person become very aggressive towards me? And that indicates that the stock is not as high as I thought. So that of course, to understanding the stock in a relationship itself is a different class. But I think if we become sensitive to that, we become attuned to at least thinking about that, then we won't take the other person for granted. Or don't take the relationship for granted. Did that answer your question? Thank you. Any last question? Yes, please. Yeah. Is there any question about the class specifically? Okay, sure.
Recently I was hearing a class of like Parikshit Maharaj and Uttara. So I got the like information that Uttara, even after death of Abhimanyu, did not perform the sati as we understand. So somehow or other in India, although here sati committed emulation for a different reason, but that has become a condemnable thing for the Indian culture. Yeah. So I had a question regarding this. Like we see in scripture, like Uttara did not commit sati because Abhimanyu, Parikshit Maharaj was there in Avu. Next, Madri did not commit sati. So
Kunti.
So that means it is understood that they should commit sati. So as a sensible person, like I was just thinking that how can Vedic culture allow this, that we do not create a facility for widows to live and give them a secure place, rather they are encouraged, or it is understood okay to be, you know, that ladies that get sati. So I don't you can just clarify like the cultural context of modern and
So was sati mandatory? Why did Vedic culture not create a facility for widows to be taken care of? First thing is that Vedic culture was quite diverse. That if you consider when Bhishma went to get the hand of Madri for the Kuru princess. At that time, the Madra king told him that in our tradition, if a girl is to be given in marriage, the boy has to give a bride price. And Bhishma said, yes, I know about it. And he had brought chariots of gifts to give. Now the bride price is actually completely opposite of the concept of dowry. And Bhishma did not impose, you know, you should give dowry, not that I give bride price. He accepted that. So actually, there was a lot of diversity according to time, place, circumstance. And their local cultures, and they were also respected. So Sati was a part of not entirely Indian culture also, it was Brahminical culture. It is among the Dvijas, Brahmana, Kshatriya, Vaishyas, sometimes the women would enter into the fire with the husband. But it was never forced. And as far as facility for widows is concerned, there's no. I think in the Bhagavatam only it is said, or at least Mahabharata said that after the Kurukshetra war got over, then Yudhishthira Maharaj actually his whole rehabilitation was the program of that. He had to look after the orphans and the widows. So he created facilities for them. So it's not that everybody had to go Sati. That was not at all true. Historically speaking, three things happened. That when Britain started ruling India, when the Muslims came to India and they ruled India, at one level they were very aggressive in desecrating temples and things like that. But at another level, they became a part of Indian culture. And they realized that India is so big that we cannot administer it ourselves. So there was a whole traditional system of landlords and people who were peasants working on the fields. And they continued that system most of the times. When the British came to India and they colonized India, at that time they were even lesser in number. And the diversity of India just was too much for them. So they tried to see, they realized that we have to respect the religious customs of India. Their religion is too strong a force. Some of them wanted to convert Indians, but not all of them, to Christianity. We will respect the religious customs. But what are the religious customs? So that time, they tried to impose a standardization on India. So for example, they tried to make the Manusmriti the standard book. Now, was Manusmriti the standard book? And Prabhupada talks about Manusmriti, if you see, he says we have to follow the rules of God. And he used Manusmriti as an example. But many of the injunctions in Manusmriti, Prabhupada did not try to implement them within his comments. So, Manusmriti was never, there's no one smriti that was universal all over India. Manu himself says that according to time, place, circumstance, even his what he has said can be revised. And Dharma Shastra is a very broad genre. There are different people had their different customs and different traditions, and they were accepted. So what happened is, in trying to homogenize everything, so they wanted to decide, okay, this is what we can accept, this is what we will outlaw. So one of the practices they outlawed was Sati. And somehow the way things happened is that maybe they didn't do some of the things more sensitively. So when they said Sati cannot be done, it's some Indians said, how dare you interfere with our culture? And then to some extent, as far as statistics, we don't have that much, but there's a whole book written on Sati as a historical practice. So according to statistics that are available, in the 18th century, 19th century, the number of Satis that happened were more than in the 15th and 16th century. Because the British said no, and then that created a sort of rebellion against it. And then when a woman would go in for Sati, she would be honored. And she would be celebrated. And that created a pressure on other women, that if I want to be other, I have to also do like this. And then some women rebelled against it. So it became a very complicated mess. It was not that Sati was a universal practice which every single woman had to do. As you rightly pointed out in the Bhagavatam itself, there are many cases where Sati is not done. And who hasn't done Sati is not condemned at all, for that matter. So, there is a tendency to try to reduce the complexity of the broad Vedic culture to homogeneity. And that has led to certain evils being aggravated much more than what they are. We're not denying that the evils were there. There are times when sati was forced, and that is reprehensible. But it was something which was done voluntarily and occasionally. And there was facility for people to live even if it was not done. Now, last point is that about this, when certain practices might have been in the tradition. We have to see that scripture has certain things which is prescriptive and certain things which is descriptive. So that means scripture may on many occasions describe that this was how it was done at that time. But just because something was done at that time, that does not mean it has to be done like this right now. That there are descriptive sections of scripture. Which, for example, say during Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's time, Haridas Thakur was not allowed to enter into Jagannath temple. That's descriptive. Is that a prescriptive thing that nobody should be allowed? No, they're simply describing how things were at that time. So, sati is it a prescription? None of the acharyas have said like that. Bhaktisiddhanta Thakur did not say, Prabhupada did not say. So, it was something which was done at that time. And now, it's not required. It's not only not required, it's not at all a prescription. It's banned, and we recognize that today it will be grievously misused. So, it's certain practices in the tradition which were there, first of all explain it in their context at that point. But you have to be clear, this is not at all a prescriptive thing. It's simply descriptive of how things were at that time. Does that answer your question? So, thank you very much. Gantra Srimad Bhagavatam ki, Srila Prabhupada ki, Gaur Bhaktadanda ki, Gaur Premanande.